Jesus is the answer for the world today. Good morning, everyone. Pastor Esther here with another devotional as we continue our survey, 30 Saturdays through the Bible. Last week, we looked at the death of Jesus Christ, and we talked about how the cross is the motivation for us to live a life that's pleasing unto God. The reason why I live holy, the reason why I obey God is because on the cross, he proved his love for me. And so the reasonable response for me, for you, for any believer, when we think about just the greatness of God's love for us, that while we were sinners, while we were still in a mess, while we were still not right with God, while we were enemies with him, he came and took our place. The punishment that we should have taken, he took for us. How could we not then lay down our lives willingly for Christ? So this week, it's week 26. We only have 4 more Saturdays. We are almost there. Well, we are going to be talking about Jesus's resurrection. You know, it's one thing if Jesus came and he died and that death was the payment of our sins. By Jesus shedding his blood, what he's basically done is become God's perfect lamb sacrifice. So all of God's wrath was poured out on Jesus. All the wrath that I deserve, all the wrath that you deserve, all the wrath that every single individual that has come into this earth, past, present, and every individual that will come into this earth future, the wrath of their sins was poured out on Jesus Christ. That would have been amazing, you know, to know that, wow, my sins are forgiven because Jesus took the punishment. But it didn't stop there. 3 days later, Jesus rose again. Jesus's resurrection from the grave was really a show of his power, a show of his deity. And so important for us to understand by Jesus raising from the dead, Jesus is showing not just you and I, but he's showing all of humanity that, hey, life and death are in his hands. He is king. He is Lord over death. There's one thing that no human being can escape, and that's death. At one point, we are all going to die. Many of us know people who have died. You know, science and research goes into finding ways to prolong life. Everyone wants to live longer. Everyone wants to live longer and be youthful. But there's one thing that we can do nothing about, and that is dying. But Jesus, who was fully God and fully man, he conquered death in the grave. He rose again, and there were witnesses to see that Jesus was alive. Now, what I love about this story is that, again, it doesn't stop there. God is really a God. When you think about Psalms 23, and David is writing that, he anointeth my head with oil, my cup runneth over. God is a God of running over. And so let's look at how it runs over. So Jesus dies on the cross, and that death is the payment for our sins. So because of Jesus's death, because he took our punishment, we now have full forgiveness from the Father because blood has been shed. And that blood was shed once for all. And then Jesus goes ahead and he raises from the dead, or rises from the dead, excuse me. And he shows, hey, like, I am in charge over life and death. I have all power. I am the King of Kings. I am the Lord of Lords. And you know what? If it had stopped there, it would have been even more amazing. But the story doesn't end there. Jesus tells his disciple before he even went to the cross in John chapter 14, 15 and 16, I encourage you to read it on your time, that, hey, he is not going to leave us alone. He's telling his disciples that, you guys, I got to go, you know, and I got to go because when I go, somebody's coming. And who's coming? The Holy Spirit. And he's going to dwell inside of you. So where Jesus, while he was on earth, could only be in one place at one time because he allowed himself to be restricted in such a way. The Holy Spirit is always with us 24/7. And this is where I want to focus on very quickly this morning. If you would join me in going to Romans chapter 8. I really love this chapter. This is where we find this very popular scripture. Therefore, there is now no condemnation to all those who are in Christ Jesus. This is verse 1. And you know, I would love if we didn't stop there. You know, it's really good. But if we go on, we see that it gets deeper. In verse 2, Paul continued to expound on this principle. He says, "For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and as an offering for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit." All right, let's unfold this, okay? So basically, Paul is saying, hey, you guys, listen, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, for those of us who walk after the Spirit. Because here's the deal. When Jesus came in flesh, he actually fulfilled the law that we all break. Now, when you think about the law, the easiest and simplest law to think of is the Ten Commandments, right? Take a moment and just think about three of those commandments and ask yourself, do I fulfill this commandment to the letter? Am I diligent in fulfilling this commandment every single day? And that's only 10. So what you're going to find is that you fall short. I fall short. In fact, all of humanity falls short. But Jesus came and he lived a perfect and holy life. So when he died, he was the payment. He was the offering for the fulfillment of that law. So now what happens is, because Jesus died and rose again, we receive the Holy Spirit. And when we walk according to the Holy Spirit, meaning that we are obedient to the Holy Spirit, Paul is telling us in Romans chapter 8 that, hey, you're not going to fulfill the desires, the law of the flesh. And what is that? Those desires are to sin against God. Those desires are to do what we want to do instead of what God wants us to do. Those desires are constantly yearning to break the law instead of, and what law? The law of God. All right, so let's continue, right? So let's drop down a little bit. And this is where I just want us to really get this inside of our hearts, because I believe that when you and I fully understand this, our lives are going to be radically transformed. Okay, so it says this. It says, however, this is verse 9, skipping down, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him. So, sidebar, if you've ever wondered, am I saved? Do you ever have questions about the stance or the position or where you are in Christ? If you have the Holy Spirit in you, you're a believer, because guess what? Only those who believe and put their faith and confidence in God can receive the Spirit of God. And the Holy Spirit is our mark that we are saved. So Paul goes on to say in verse 10, if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Like, whoa, right? So because the same Spirit that dwelled in Christ Jesus and raised him from the dead lives in us, we have life through the Holy Spirit. And what is that life? That life is, in this context, the power to live a holy and righteous life. Right, that life is the power to put away our idols and live a life where God is our number one priority. That life is that we have power to conquer those sins that we really, really struggle with. And what is the key? Our obedience to the Holy Spirit, whom we receive because Jesus resurrected and he went back to be with the Father. So I would encourage you today, as I'm challenging myself, Because of time, we can't go through all of Romans chapter 8, but I want to encourage you to read it and read it again and again and again and again. We can live lives that are righteous, lives that are pleasing unto God. And I know I say this all the time, but I say it because it's true. If there was ever a time where God's people, where the church needed to shine the light of Jesus Christ, it is today in 2021 and moving on. The world needs to see us, and they need to see that we live differently. They need to see that while we are in this world, we are not of this world. And we can do that because of the Holy Spirit that dwells with us. Because when Jesus resurrected, he showed that, hey, world, all power is in my hands. And he was able to resurrect through the power of the Spirit of God, through the power of the Holy Spirit at work in him. And that same Spirit dwells in you, and it dwells in me, and it dwells in anyone who believes in Jesus Christ. So today, let's be obedient to the Holy Spirit. Let's follow his leading, because guess what? He's gonna ask us to do things that are pleasing to God. Yeah, sometimes he's gonna ask us to give away things, but how can we not when Jesus gave it all up for us? So be encouraged, my brothers, my sisters, to know that the same power, the same Spirit that resurrected Jesus from the grave lives in you and lives in me. And so we have power to live a victorious Christian life. God bless you.